Ben Stark here, recording a draft video for ChannelFireball.com. We're doing M19, and whoa, what is that? A Planeswalker, Vivian Reed. And that is a good Planeswalker in Limited. It kills flying creatures, artifacts, and enchantments. It comes in with a lot of loyalty, and pretty much draws a creature right away. Since you look at four cards, you can reveal a creature or land. So even if they can kill it, the worst case scenario is you're going to get a creature out of it and then gain some life. That's not very good, but other times there's going to be a stalemate and it's just going to win the game. Also, you can play it and kill powerful enchantments and things like that. So it's a good card. It's not super broken. It's not the kind of rare that just always wins the game. Sometimes, like I said, your opponent will be ahead. It doesn't defend itself that well against non-flyers, and you'll play it and plus it, and they'll be able to kill it. Maybe you'll get to pick off one of their small creatures and they'll have to alpha it, so it'll gain you a lot of life and kill a 2/2 and replace itself with whatever you plus into. But for 5 mana, that's not a game-winning card by any means. But anyways, it's an easy pick here. My next choice would be Heroic Reinforcements, which is a really good card. I think that overall this pack is pretty weak, but Vivian Reed is a great Planeswalker. Green needs to kill flyers too. I think that Heroic Reinforcements is possibly like an amazing build around for what's possibly the best archetype in the format in Boros Aggro. That deck is so easy to go wide from both red and white with small creatures, and then you have Heroic Reinforcements making 2/2/2 hastes effectively and pumping the rest of your team. Then they turn back into 1/1s, but then you can use Inspired Charge or Angel of the Dawn to pump them again, and you have a ton of stuff out. It's a great card for a great archetype and a perfect fit. Other than that, that pack was really weak. I do like Vampire Neonate. I noticed that was in the pack. I'm not sure it would have even been my third choice of the pack, but it is a card that I often play and I don't necessarily see everyone else playing. So I just wanted to mention that I think that's a good card. Now let's move on to pack two. Shock is good, but it's not great. I've seen formats where killing small creatures was more valuable. I don't think the small creatures matter a ton in M19, but there is 2/3 mana flyers, blue and black has at common, Avon Windmage, and also I forget what it's called, Bloodletter. So being able to shock those is really good. And shock is just gonna kill a 2-drop almost every time, so it's trading up a mana. And also, I've seen a lot of races in this format, a lot of close games as far as life total, and shock does go to the player. So it's good efficient removal, but I think there's more value in killing big things than small things in this format. Arcane Encyclopedia is a new take on Jame Daytome. They just made it one less to cast and one less to use because Jame Daytome was never really playable in Limited. I think that Arcane Encyclopedia is really good against control. I think if you have a deck with a lot of removal, you can use it against aggro too, but there isn't a lot of cheap removal in this format. So really, I see that card as mostly a sideboard card. Bogart Brute is a good solid 3-drop. It's 3/2s aren't that effective in this format, but Menace makes it effective. It's hard to block. Skyscanner is a nice artifact. It's good in virtually any kind of deck. It helps you hit your land drops, but while you're still only playing 17 land. So this is a pick between Bogart Brute and Skyscanner, I think. And I think I'm going to Skyscanner. I mean, we're not red yet just because we got a shock. I mean, we're not green yet just because we got a Vivian Reed, though I hope to be green. And Skyscanner is going to be good in every kind of deck. It's kind of a nuts and bolts type card. You get a free 1/1 flyer as far as cards go because it replaces itself. And it's cheap, so it can help you hit your further land drops. And that's important because Flood is a serious problem in this format. You can't use all your lands forever that well like you could in Dominaria. But the more expensive cards are a lot more powerful than the cheap cards in this format, so you need to play them, and you still need to play like 17 land in most decks, not 18. So Skyscanner can really kind of glue that together. So out of this pack, there's Colossal Dreadmaw, which I like a lot. I think big things matter. I think big things are good. I don't think this is like Dominaria, where vanilla creatures weren't very good. I think a 6/6 Trample for 6 is an excellent card, and it's what I'm going to take out of this pack. Talons is playable if you have a lot of smaller creatures. Snapping Drake is playable if you're blue, but not super exciting. So I think this is a pretty easy Colossal Dreadmaw. I think it's probably the best card in the pack, and of course, our best card is Vivian Reed. Brawl Bash Ogre is good. I really like the fact that it's an active treason enabler. The active treason deck is very real. Despite the fact that they didn't put a common sack outlet for black, there's multiple uncommons. You have Brawl Bash Ogre, you have the Harpy, and Blood Divination. So I think that, and I think there's probably more too. I can't think of them all off the top of my head. So I think if you can start with like a Brawl Bash Ogre, then you can draft your Dragon Eggs and your Active Treasons and draft that deck. The only thing is you can't count on getting SAC outlets later because they are uncommon. Of course, that's not what we're really trying to do. We're green. Green is our best color. But you never know what will splash. This card is so much better than everything else in the pack. I'm not going to take, I don't even know, like the 2-mana 2-2 green elf there with Vigilance over Brawl Bash Ogre in pack one. Maybe we'll play green-black or green-red, and we'll just pick up a free source or two and want to splash this for some reason. We probably won't use this Brawl Bash Ogre, but like I said, we didn't really miss out on anything there. So Elvish Clan Caller is interesting. If you get two, it's really good, and there are quite a few elves, so if you have one, it's okay to pump your elves. But if you have one, it's off and on exciting, and if you have two, it's really good, assuming you have a decent amount of other elves. Giant Spider is good, especially if your deck is more late-game oriented, which ours is. We already have a flyer that draws a card, a powerful Planeswalker, if we can protect it, that'll win the game, and a 6-6 Trample. So I think this is more of a late-game deck than an aggro deck, so I think we're going to be taking Giant Spiders here. We're looking to protect our life total and protect our Vivian Reed, and then we should be able to win with Vivian, with Dreadmaw, and with future big things we pick up. And along those lines, I think Marauder's Axe is really good for enabling cheap creatures, cheap utility creatures, creatures that comes into play effects like Sky Scanner. I just don't think that's the direction we want to go in this draft, building around Vivian and Dreadmaw already. So I think Wall of Vines could be a good sideboard card against Flyers, but I think Tranquil Expanse is actually a better pickup. White has Luminous Bonds and Take Vengeance that are very splashable removal. Additionally, we're only green at this point. We have Shock as basically our only red card and a Brawl Bash Ogre if red and black. And I would almost certainly not splash for this card in a green control deck. On the other hand, though, if we pick up synergies, if we open like the Elder Dragon, the Jund one, and we want to splash anyway or something, it can be a nice card. So Giant Spider here, I think, is a pretty easy pick. We're not doing an active treason red-black deck. We're green. Like I said, Giant Spider is kind of the exact card our green deck wants. Infernal Hellion is good. I think that people might underrate that. The dying and a turn isn't a huge deal. It's a great blocker. It kills basically any ground creature. And then sometimes you attack, they have to trade their 3 or 4, drop 4, you deal them 4 or 5. Another card I like is Fountain of Renewal. If you're against control, this card isn't good, but it cycles. 4 mana is an expensive cycle, but it still cycles, so you didn't mulligan. If you're against aggro, which a lot of decks are in this format, you play that thing turn 1, that's 8, 9, 10 life, because as you're gaining an extra 1 every turn for no mana, the game's going to go longer and you're going to gain even more life. And if you're a late game deck and they're an aggro deck, this life is very valuable. And if you draw a really land heavy hand and you don't have anything to do, you can still sacrifice it. Or if you draw a 3 land hand and you need to hit your land drop, then on turn 4 or 5 when you're out of gas, you can sacrifice it. So, of course, this card is not great or anything, but it's very main deckable because it cycles against control where it would be bad. And I think the way you gain one a turn makes the game go longer so that you gain even more life. I think that's really effective against aggressive decks. Catalyst Elemental could be cool. Waltz is probably the best card in the pack, but we didn't really see any black, so I'm not really counting on going there. You never know what you're going to open. It's still an option, but ramping out some of these big things can be effective against certain types of decks. Even if I don't start something like Catalyst Elemental because that plan is bad, sometimes you play against like red-green, for example, and they just can't do anything about a 6-6 on turn 4. If you're playing against blue-white, obviously, you don't want to sack a card to play a 6-6 on turn 4 because they're probably going to be able to enchant it with Luminous Bonds or Dwindle, or maybe they have an uncommon like the new Manowar. I forget what its name is, Exclusion Mage or something like that. Plummet and Naturalize are good sideboard cards, so that's a good pickup. Hey, and another great pickup for our red-green deck, the Dragon Queen. So even if you get zero other dragons, there's absolutely nothing wrong with a 6-6 flying 2-mana fire breathing. Now, if you play a single other dragon after it and you get an additional 5-5 flyer, that's just absolutely broken. So just one more dragon after this, and that's just an incredibly good card. You just spent 6 mana. The other dragon, let's say, is a normal card. Let's say it's like the common one or something. But now this 6-mana card, you spent 6, and you got a 6-6 flying and a 5-5 and the pump ability. So this is a lot better than Shock. This card is incredible, especially for our defensive deck with 2 Giant Spiders, with Fountain Renewal, Vivian already. Plus, we have the ability to ramp it out with this Catalyst Elemental. I really like the direction this deck is going. This deck really wants Druid of the Cow, but we can't take it over Lathless. I might take Druid over Shock in some circumstances. At this point, I would probably take Shock, but I'm not sure. Also worth mentioning, I think, is Rabid Bite is a lot better than Ancient Animus. It's not a fight. It's just one-sided removal. So that's a first pickable quality removal spell. It's not like the last format or some formats where the green fight spell is situational. The green has a common Death Touch creature, the 3-mana 2/2, and then you can kill anything, and it always lives because it's not a fight. It's just dealing damage. And even if you don't have that, green has plenty of big creatures, Thornhide Wolves, Colossal Dreadmaw, and they're very playable. This isn't a format where you're like, oh, I have to toss these big creatures in my deck to make my fight spell work. This is a format where you want your big creatures. Speaking of big creatures, Hungering Hydra is not incredible or anything. It doesn't kill opposing creatures. It's not that kind of Hydra. But if they chump it, it grows. And other than that, basically, it's an XX for a green. A little bit more bonus than that. And basically, that's a good card for a green controlling ramp deck because it's like a split card that you can cast on whatever turn you need to. Like, if your opponent's coming out of the gates and you don't have a 2-2 or anything to do on turn 3, you'd get run over and lose. Instead, you can play a 2-2 and trade with their 2 or 3 drop. If, on the other hand, you have other stuff to do, but you don't have anything to do on turn 4, you play it as a 3-3. On turn 5, as a 4-4. If you draw it in the late game, it's a 10-10 or whatever. Probably not a 10-10, but you get the point. So, basically, the fact that it's kind of this super adjustable card is really good for green late game decks. They're going to have plenty of mana sources and need to keep up with aggro decks and have pretty good threat density if you're trying to win the late game. And this deck is really coming together very nicely now with this XX creature, with the two good six drops, with Vivian, double spider, a shock. I like Skyscanner in decks like this. This is really what you want a red-green dinosaurs control-ish deck to look like. So this pack isn't going to help us really, though. Talons is okay in an aggressive green deck. It's actually pretty good because you never get 2-for-1. It's just this floating +1/+1 that you have for the whole game. We're not looking to give our Lathless or Colossal Dreadmaw +1/+1. It does give Trample, so it's kind of good with Hungering Hydra, but that's not really a concern. So I'm going to take Luminous Bonds. We already have a green-white dual land here. It's pretty easy to splash a Luminous Bonds. Luminous Bonds is really good quality removal. Wow. Dryad Greenseeker is something I would consider broken. I mean, if you play that thing on turn 2 and activate it every turn, you just have way more spells over the course of the game than your opponent because you take the land off the top of your deck so often, and then you don't miss land drops because you're going deeper into your deck. This card is just excellent. Nothing really else to say about it. It's first pickable. It's one of the best green cards, I think, in the set. I think it's just a very good card. I think it's honestly just a mistake. I think it should have cost 3 mana for sure. It would still be a good card at 3 mana. So Luminous Bonds, though, is very splashable. We already have a Tranquil Expanse. If we pick up one more source, and this deck can use ramp and stuff, so if we pick up like Gifts that gains life, that card is quite good in a deck like this and we'll definitely splash. If we don't, we'll have to look at the mana requirements. At this point, we have a double red card, so I probably won't splash without a single other source, but already having a green-white duel, we could pick up a red-white duel, another green-white duel, even a green-red duel helps you splash. And a Mana Lith, a Gifts of Paradise. There's plenty of time to get like one more source to make the mana good. So in this pack, I think the best card for us is probably Rock's Oracle. I like that it draws a card and helps us get to land 6 to play these 2 6 drops. Sometimes I think this card is overrated. If you're not going to use the lands you draw off of it at all ever, then you draw a land like 40%+ of the time if you're playing 16 or 17 lands. So it's a 5-mana 4/2. A lot of the time. Of course, some of the time you do draw a spell off it. So I think for green aggro decks as like a curved topper, I don't think Rock's Oracle is very good. But if you're a deck like ours, where you're going to want to use tons of mana, or maybe you're going to still be using land 6, 7, 8, playing 2 things because you have Hungering Hydra at X, Vivian Reed drawing cards. I can't believe that's another Dryad Greenseeker. I guess green is being underdrafted at this table, but this card is incredible. I know that I drafted a lot of green pack one and didn't pass very much, but there's a Rabid Bite, which is a very, very good green common, probably the best one. It's good quality removal. And then there's this broken uncommon that should not be in the pack right now. So this is just an amazing deck at this point. And so Dragon's Horde is really good fixing. It will let us splash Luminous Bonds. We already have a dragon, and we're going to prioritize dragons pretty highly, given how good the synergy is with Lathless here. But there's also Giant Spider, which is a card we really want, but we already have two of. And there's also Rabid Bite, which is a card we really want, like I was just saying. Great green common removal, probably the best green common. Maybe the ramp card might be better. The 2-mana 1/3 that adds a green, that's a card that would be excellent for this deck. So this is a tough pick. We don't need third Giant Spider. We would play three for sure, but we need it less than these other two cards. I think the ramp is just more valuable for our deck, given how good our late game is, and given that puts Luminous Bonds in the deck. I think, and we already have a dragon sub-theme, I think it's the vast majority of the time I would be taking the Rabid Bite there. I want to point out, again, that is really good removal, and I hope to get some. But this deck is just like a ramp deck. We can draw cards, we have an X spell, we have a dragon to ramp into, and we had a Luminous Bonds we kind of wanted to splash, and Dragon Sword adds any kind of mana. So, and we already have a dragon to draw a card with after if we have a Horde out. So I think that right now for this deck, Dragon Sword was the right pick, but that's not a pick I would expect to make very often. Highland Game is not a good card. I boarded in against aggro, but it's not a card I like to start. I think 2-mana 2/1s are pretty bad in this format. There's a lot of cards that punish them pretty well. Even if you're playing in some of the aggro decks or go-wide decks, this card isn't good if your opponent plays Goblin Instigator. You want to trade with half that and gain 2 life, they still have a 1-1 in play. Some decks, of course, are trying to attack you with 2/2s and 2/1s and 3/2s, and then it's a good card. And if we end up short 2-drops, we'll use it against them. But overall, Highland Game is not impressive to me. I would much prefer stuff like Fountain of Renewal to not die to aggro than something like Highland Game. I guess Rogue's Gloves could be a sideboard card, though I doubt we're going to use it. Catalyst Elemental is something I could actually see this deck using. Like I said, it might be a sideboard card because it's too risky against some strategies, but we have some stuff to ramp into here. So this is a tough pick, actually, between these two cards, not Highland Game. We're going to splash white. We have two sources already for free. Invoke is a great sideboard card, but we do have a Naturalize. Thornhide Wolves is a good 5-drop. It's big. It has toughness. I think that's a card we want. But we do have a lot of late game already, so that was probably close. Because I looked at a Naturalize in the sideboard, I decided to go with the Thornhide Wolves. Tormenting Voice is actually a card we'll probably main one of, so I shouldn't put that in the sideboard. We're going to play 17 lands, but we need to make our land drops. Sometimes we're going to get flooded with 17 lands and Fountain of Renewals and Dragon's Horde, Sky Scanners, so then we're going to need to discard a land. You can't spend that much time during games casting Tormenting Voice, but it's a nice one-off for decks like this. Wow, there's another really good card. Sarkhan's on Ceiling. If you prioritize creatures having 4 power, that card is incredible. We already have one potential 7-power creature. We can play this for 8 mana and then blow up their world. But we also have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 4-power creatures, and we still have the rest of this pack to go. So I think that's a pretty clear pick. It's really not competing with much. Luminous Bonds would be good to splash. Of course, we're going to splash one, we'd splash two. But I think Sarkhan's on Ceiling is just a lot more powerful. We don't have a ton of 4-drops. We've got lots of good stuff to play behind it. So I think that's a pretty clear pick. I think this is a really good card in some types of decks. Of course, it varies greatly, but Vivian Reed is practically a 4-power creature too, just on delay, because if you plus it and you have this many 4-power creatures, you'll probably hit one. Plus, it'll help us find our dragons, the Vivian Reed and stuff. So I think Sarkhan's on Ceiling fits really nicely into what this deck is doing. Lightning Mirror is not impressive. It's very easy to block. I think Departed Deckhand is actually really good. That card might be underrated. It's 2-mana 2/2 unblockable. Basically doesn't have a drawback. Your opponent can kill a Titanic Growth, but any removal is going to kill it anyway. And a 2-mana 2/2 unblockable is a very good card. And then when you throw in its ability, it becomes absurd. Like, you can pay 4 and make any creature unblockable. So I think that card is really, really good for blue aggro decks. The only thing is blue tends to be pretty controlling in this format, in which case it's still a good card because control decks need to win the game and it's efficient. But it's much better if you're like a blue-green or blue-white aggro type deck. So now we have some interesting picks. Elvish Rejuvenator is a card I definitely want to pick up one of. But Sparktongue Dragon with the Dragon Queen, with the ramp we already have, plus Dragon Sword, I think has to be the pick. This is another one of those picks where there's a lot of green-red decks where I would take Rejuvenator over Sparktongue Dragon. But we're pretty good at ramping. We have Dried Green Seekers to hit our land drops, Dragon's Horde to ramp, and Catalyst Elementals if we want them. And Catalyst Elemental goes really well with this Sparktongue Dragon because that means we only need 6 lands in play to then play this and deal 3 to something. And you're pretty happy to turn your 3-drop into a Lightning Bolt. So I think that I hope to pick up a Rejuvenator this pack, especially since we're going to splash. Very light splash at the moment. But Sparktongue Dragon with the Lathless, I think, is just the card we have to take, basically. So a look at this pack. Psy, Master Thopterist is really good in blue artifact decks. Of course, we can't use that. Druid of Horns is really good with the Talons in decks playing a lot of Auras, but we, of course, aren't going to try and do that. Thornhide Wolves, just generic, good fatty. Titanic Growth, I actually think, is really good in a lot of green decks. If you're going to be attacking a lot of the time, your opponent has to block. That can kill virtually any sized creature. And even if you're going to have to block and use it, there's not that much good instant removal. That said, our creatures are gigantic. We don't expect to need to win games that way. So for me, Titanic Growth would be a sideboard card right now, but in most green decks, I think it's a good main deck trick. I think it's something you normally play. So this is just an unexciting but perfectly fine Thornhide Wolves. We want our four power creatures for our Sarkhan's Unsealing and just to win late games because that's what our deck is trying to do. So we don't mind picking this up, but this is an unexciting pick, I would say. I'd much rather see a Druid of the Cow or an Elvish Rejuvenator. Honestly, even a Rock's Oracle is probably better than a Thornhide Wolves for our deck since we can really use mana well, but it's still a card that we might need. So here there's a pick between two cards, Daggerback, Basilic, and Rock's Oracle. We don't have any of the Rabid Bites, but this is still a great blocker. It can trade up, and it's cheap. We have enough fatties. I think Rock's Oracle is a little better than Thornhide Wolves in our deck, but ultimately, this is five drops, or however you want to view this card, plus more behind it. So I think it's important to pick up some earlier drops to make sure we don't get run over. So I think we're going to take Basilic there. Okay, and I'm pretty happy to pick up a Stone Quarry. That's the red-white duel. So now we don't have to play a single Plains in our deck. We don't have any ways to search for a Plains, but we get three sources off of just Dragon's Horde and these two dual lands. And I don't mind a tap land in a control deck like this. It could be obnoxious if you draw it on the wrong turn late, but honestly, you probably have a different land to play, or at least you're just casting something one casting cost lower or something like that. So I don't think it's likely to cost us a game, and I think Luminous Bonds could easily win us a game. We don't have that much quality removal. This deck is really powerful. Our proactive game is really strong, but our removal is only Vivian can kill flyers, Luminous Bonds that we're splashing for, and Shock. So I think Luminous Bonds is an important splash. Here I'm going to take Goblin Instigator. The vast majority of red decks are going to take Bogart Brood over Goblin Instigator, but we're not aggressive at all. On the other hand, if our opponent is trying to rush us and trying to go wide, this giving two bodies is for two mana is much more valuable than a 3-mana 3/2 aggressive creature. It's just a pretty unique deck we have going. I mean, this is a deck in this format, certainly with Giant Spider and two different ramp commons with the Druid that adds mana and the Rejuvenator. You're going to draft green-red ramp sometimes, but the majority of red decks are red aggro decks, in which case Bogart Brood is most likely better than Goblin Instigator. But of course, this deck is not aggressive in the slightest. And Plummet's a strong sideboard card. Maybe we'll main one with how little removal we got, but even if we don't main it, it's a strong sideboard card. Kind of wish we had drafted Black-Red Active Treason, because this would be our third Brawl Bash Ogre, and our deck would be ridiculous. But our green-red deck is pretty ridiculous, too. Green was wide open at this table. We got two Dryad Green Seekers and Vivian Reed. So basically, green, it's weird because we're not seeing a lot of black. We're seeing a lot of green and red, and we're seeing these red, black, gold cards. So basically, we could have had like a heavy red aggressive deck with the Brawl Bash Ogre's Active Treasons, and that deck would have been really good, or we could have the deck we had. And since we started with Vivian, the deck we had is where we should end up. Because it's not like, of course you drop a first pick quality card like Vivian if you're not seeing green, but we're clearly seeing green. None of these are cards I really want, but I would board in Wall of Vines against some aggro decks. I might board in Marauder's Axe if I play against a control deck, but once again, none of these are cards I really want. I could see a matchup where I bring in Titanic Growth. More likely, I'll want a second Tormenting Voice. I might even just play two, then I will that other card. Okay, so this deck looks quite good. There happens to be exactly 23 laid out. I'm sure I'm going to play exactly 17, even though this deck needs to make land drops for a long time. Dragon's Horde is a land, Skyscanner as a land, and Dryad Greenseeker does help you hit later land drops. Like, if you only have a two-land hand, it doesn't necessarily help you hit a land drop by that much. I mean, you can draw, and then after you brick, you can see just the top card. But ultimately, over the course of a game, if you have lands, you're going to be able to hit land drop 6 and 7 more often if you have a Greenseeker out, because you're just getting through your deck quicker, drawing extra cards. So, and Fountain Renewal Cycle, too. So there's just no way I would play 18 in this deck. But what I would consider is a second Tormenting Voice, because we don't have a lot of cheap cards here. So if I need to Tormenting Voice away a late game card earlier to ensure I have a smoother mid game, or if I need to Tormenting Voice away a land to ensure I can do things on turn 3 and 4, I'm cool with that, because I only have a couple of plays early. I wouldn't mind a Plummet main. I wouldn't mind like a Wall of Vines to slow down aggro decks because our deck isn't very fast. But I think that should probably be like sideboard strategy. I don't think we really want two Catalyst Elementals main. I could see maining one, but we have enough other three drops that I don't think we want to main two. I really hate maining stuff like Highland Game and Goblin Instigator in this format, but I might do it because our late game is just so strong. I really just don't want to get run over. So I think I'm going to put in Goblin Instigator. Even though I love Goblin Instigator and like Boros Aggro Go Wide, which I think honestly is probably the best archetype in this format, but it's really too early to say. And I love it in basically any good red aggro deck that can enhance bodies, that is playing equipment. I don't like it in decks like this, and I don't want it. But we only have two cards that we can play that impact the board on turn two, and I'll block with those if I have to, but I honestly don't even want to do that. So I think that Goblin Instigator should be in our main deck here. I'm cool with the one Catalyst Elemental, although honestly, I might cut it too. We didn't end up with a ton of expensive top end, so I think we'll be pretty good at hitting our land drops. So I think basically we can play 17, choose to play still. We have these fountains, we have these green seekers to help get their one turn early. So I think we just want to have some two mana cards to do. So I think I'm going to play the Tormenting Voice because I want to make sure I hit land drop three. Maybe we can cut something expensive though instead of the Catalyst Elemental. Hydra's not cuttable. These sixes really aren't cuttable. So Thornhide Wolves is our most cuttable big card. But yeah, we need the fours for Sarkhan's Unsealing and stuff. I'm just going to cut Catalyst Elemental. Okay, so this looks cool. Powerful late game, the fountains to gain life, the Tormenting Voices to smooth our draws. 9-7-1's about right. We got to stick in the dual lands. Stone Quarry for a mountain. And I'm not going to play this Plains. I think that's just going to be another mountain. And then cut a forest for Tranquil Expanse. So we're basically 9-8, 9 green, 8 red, which is clearly the right land count because we have double Green Seeker, double Tormenting Voice, but considerably more green cards than red, but we have double red cards and all that. So this is a deck that wants to be 9-8 and 9 green, 8 red. And then the Luminous Bonds, we have three sources for with Dragon's Horde, Stone Quarry, and Tranquil Expanse, as well as two Tormenting Voices. So it practically is a free splash. The only requirement is basically we have to play these tap lands. Let's go to round one. Round one, the sweet green-red ramp deck with the great late game. Kind of a scary hand with two lands on the play. But we have a dried Green Seeker. I'm not going to mull this. Just we have a 3-drop that's green, a 4-drop that's green. This hand is not loaded with late game cards or anything. So hopefully we'll draw one land, either this draw step, next draw step, or off the Green Seeker. And then we can cast the Basilisk, and then we get another draw step and another Green Seeker activation. So hopefully we get there, because this deck is really awesome, and I'll be very disappointed to not be able to play with it. But I don't think I would ever mulligan this hand. Okay, so it's not like if I activate it and get a mountain that's really going to change anything, so I'll just leave the Green Seeker up. I wouldn't play a tap land this turn because I have a 3-drop and I don't have any 2-drops. If I had a 2-drop, even if it was a little worse than this Basilisk, I might activate it now because I do need to get those tap lands in play. Like, if I find a tap land with these activations and that's my only next land, I can't play anything this turn. But if I found a tap land there, I wasn't going to play it over Basilisk, so there's not really much reason to go ahead and activate main phase there. So end of turn, Rock's Oracle, not a land. We do want to look for our land, so I'm going to activate now. Hopefully we find one. Fountain, not a terrible card to see, but way worse than a land. I'm not going to attack with this Basilisk so they can block and make a 2-2 and attack me back. Since I tapped the Greenseeker main phase, all I really want out of this game is to keep my life total as high as I can. So I get time to find lands. My deck is incredible, but currently we're stuck on lands. We're not. We're only taking two. We've got a couple things out. We're drawing a card that will gain us a life and then cycle. And we might even be able to cycle it immediately if we find an untapped land off the Green Seeker activation. So I don't hate the spot. We just basically want to keep our life total up and hopefully find lands. So activate Green Seeker because we might get an untapped land to play Spider. And we do. Sweet. This card is incredible. Dried Green Seeker. And that was a nice pull. Now we can play Fountain and sack it in the same turn. If we're really bricking, Hopefully we'll just draw a land and we should be pretty much home free on casting things. Doesn't mean we're definitely going to win after the stall for one turn. The opponent has a nice draw here with 2, 3, 4 and pretty aggressive stuff. But I'm happy to kind of be online. And we can't really get blown out here. Like, if the opponent attacks with 2-headed zombie, we could double block. I'm not super happy about losing the spider, but we're still at 17. The opponent had Spirit Flame, which is a really good removal, one I would have loved to grab with our dragons. So now that they had the removal for the spider, though, we can't block, so we're taking a hard hit here for 6. So, didn't find a land, but did find a Green Seeker, which means we can double block with Green Seeker and Basilisk on 2-headed zombie if we don't find the land. If we find a land, I'd much rather cast one of these 5s, I think. So let's go ahead and activate now. And there's no way I'm going to spend this turn playing Fountain and activating it. I have to add to this board. Now, I can't play Rocks Oracle here if I'm going to double block, which I do want to, because then the opponent would just kill both. So Thornhide Wolves is a clear play. Hopefully they don't have another removal. There's not a ton. There is some, though, and they are Black-Red, the deck that traditionally has the most removal. So this could get dicey. Okay, they didn't have one, so that's really good. This is hitting me for 2 a turn, this Bloodletter, but I've got a Fountain, which is going to cut that in half. If I find a white source, I can take care of it. Even if I need to just cast the Sparktongue Dragon, not for 8 mana, I will. We'll see what happens on our next turn. So another Menace creature is a little scary. Red-Black does have good flyers and Menace creatures, which is what I like aggression to be in this format. I think trying to be able to get in with small ground creatures is very tough and not something you should want to do unless you're going to Inspire Charge or equipment, you know, and enhance them or put an aura on them. But Menace creatures can attack just fine. It's pretty hard to have 2 blockers. So now we have some options. I do need to have a bunch of blockers up to stop these Menace creatures. I wouldn't mind casting anything. There's no way we'll cast Hungering Hydra because I just assume cast Rocks Oracle. But I might want to activate the Green Seeker because hitting a land would be very good. I could also try and hit the land with Rocks Oracle. If I hit a tap land, I can play it. If I hit an on-tap land, I can play the Fountain. I do kind of want to get this Fountain in play. So I might take this turn and just play Fountain and Green Seeker. I feel like stranding mana is kind of rough, though. We have a handful of spells, so that play is probably not right. So I think ultimately I really just want to try and hit my land, but I need to have this Green Seeker up to jump in on a double block. So Rocks Oracle is probably the play. See if we get there or what we draw. Hopefully we get a land. Sweet. So now we can play the Fountain of Renewal and we can double block and we can use the Green Seeker for one more peek. And we don't need a ton more land. Of course, Green Seeker is amazing in the late game because you're going to draw more spells if you clear lands from the top of your deck anytime they're there. But keeping my life total up is more important when I have a hand this powerful. We have an 8 mana card that will kill their flyer or their 4-2 Menace. We have an XX here. So, and we have a removal spell, and sooner or later we'll find one of the 3 planes. So basically, keeping my life total up is priority number 1 here. And along those lines, I'm going to double block the bigger of the 2 Menace creatures. But I can't block both of these, so I have to take 5, which I'm not super happy about, but there's nothing I can do. I have 3 blockers, and that can only block 1 Menace creature. So here you see how effective Menace is being. Dealing 4 to Thornhide Wolves tells me they're probably going to play Skeleton Archer and finish it off. Or Plague Mare. Not a huge blowout or anything, but a solid card. And end of turn, we'll try and draw a land and succeed. Probably not going to be sacking that anytime soon, so let's go ahead and auto-yield. And really, I need to get as many bodies in play this turn as I can, but I'm only 1 turn away from Sparktongue Dragon now, so I think we're going to start with the Sky Scanner and see what we get, only I'm not going to tap like that because we have a Mountain in hand. Because I don't mind chumping at this point. Next turn, I'm most likely Sparktongue and take out like their Menace or their Flyer, probably the Flyers, unless surprising things happen. And the opponent's down to 1 card in hand, and we've still got 5 life, which is a little scary with Lobax in the format and Menace and Bloodletter and all that, but we have the Fountain and we don't have to sack it. We'll just let it tick up and make sure we stay alive for the long run if the opponent doesn't kill us now. So Along those lines, I think I'm actually going to go super weak, and I'm going to actually play this Hungering Hydra for one, just to throw it in on a double block. The way, now that we already have land eight, all I really want to do here is not die, and the opponent emptied their hand. This game could have went different ways, but having the game go this way now, where we still have Spark Tongue in hand, we have land eight in hand, we have the Fountain out, and we have Green Seekers, two of them, we're going to win the long game. So all I really want to do here is not die. So I really didn't mind putting out this 1-1 Hydra just to ensure that I'm not taking hits from this Menace if they have removal. It might not have been necessary. It might have been a little overly cautious. But I really don't think I'll need this Hungering Hydra to win this game. And there's a creature we may need to kill more than the Bloodletter with the Spark Tongue. We can always Luminous Bonds the Bloodletter later. And we have another Spider to draw as well as a Shock. Granted, the Shock takes care of Gutter Snipe. But at six life, I'm not trying to take chances with the opponent just drawing some good instants, maybe a Tormenting Voice. So I think this is a pretty easy turn. We already had our land drop. We just take out Gutter Snipe and pass the turn back to the opponent. Attacks wouldn't be profitable. They would just trade a 2-2 for a 4-2 or chump it and get a 2-2. And now we can kind of go into late game mode. We can sit behind Fountain, clear lands, hopefully draw a lot more spells than the opponent, draw two cards with Tormenting Voice, discarding a land, find a white source. We're halfway through our deck. There's still three in there. And it's really comforting having the Fountain of Renewal out, because that's going to take away a lot of potential outs from the opponent. And we would have drawn a land this turn, but we didn't because of Dryad Greenseeker. This is how powerful this card is. So I'm going to start off with Tormenting Voice because we still have enough mana to cast Thornhide Wolves. See what we get. Okay, Colossal Dreadmaw works for me. I do want to keep making land drops, but I'm going to hold one in case they have Mind Rot. And even though two of my three white sources come into play tapped, I don't think it's like an urgent problem. Even if they draw removal for this Spark Tongue, they're going to put us to five, we're going to go back to six. We can play the tap land next turn. So I think for now, just going to sit around and gain a life and clear lands from the top of my deck and dig to some of the power cards. And of course, this Dreadmaw will probably attack. Well, that's a strong draw by the opponent. They have two Doom Dissenters out, so they're going to get to see a lot of extra cards now themselves. I like my chances with my deck having a more powerful late game than theirs, but we might be in a little bit more of a hurry now to get our late game fully online and start attacking. And of course, they're going to sack Doom Dissenter. So far, they hit a Mountain. Now, I don't know the casting cost of their cards, so I can't. This lets you play anything to end a turn, but doesn't let you play them for free. So it probably makes sense for them to wait and use it next turn because they want to untap their lands. They don't want to hit a Lich's Caress or something and not be able to play it. But once again, I don't know the casting cost of my opponent's cards. So we're going to untap and draw this Tormenting Voice. I think we can afford to tap one Green Seeker now, clear the top card if it is a land, and then Tormenting Voice. If it's not a land, then we'll Tormenting Voice right away. I think that makes sense to do, though. I'm not 100%. It's a Shock, which is a nice pickup. We can then take care of this Dark Dweller, Oracle, or the Bloodletter. I'll probably take care of the Oracle. They have a lot of small creatures out. Take my chances with the Bloodletter, with a Spark Tongue and a Fountain. So we're definitely going to Tormenting Voice, discarding Forest. And with the Thornhide Wolves, we'll be able to deal four to the Bloodletter next turn. So this turn seems like Shock, Dark Dweller, Oracle for sure. I think I'll attack with just Colossal Dreadmaw. That still leaves us plenty of blockers. Honestly, they might have an Act of Treason or something. I don't even know if I want to send the Dreadmaw. Granted, Dreadmaw is the creature they'd probably Act of Treason, so that kind of gives us some reason to go ahead and send it. First, we'll shock this Dark Dweller. We don't want to do it on their turn, because then they'd sack it. It's not sack another creature. You can sack itself. See if they hit anything that changes my opinion. Like, if they hit a removal here, I might play Thornhide Wolves. I really just don't want to lose. Like, when I say lose, I mean die. We're in such a favorable board position where we should definitely be playing conservative. But at 8 life, and they have a 2-2 and a 2-2 and a 1-1, I can certainly afford to play the Sarkin's Unsealing now. They have one card in hand. It's most likely a land. I do want to keep the life total as high as we can, though, because right now we might die to Banefire, let's say, or Lavax. We have to double block, and we take 3. So we do die to those cards. And if we keep enough blockers up after, and Fountain keeps ticking, we won't die to those cards or literally anything. So I'm not even 100% sure it was right to attack with the Dreadmaw. Holding it back might have kept us out of range of Lavax and Banefire. So honestly, I think it might have even been a mistake. Hopefully I won't get punished. I'm pretty sure they aren't holding those cards because they would have beaten me already. But they still could top deck one. And honestly, we're in good enough shape now, especially with the Sarkin's Unsealing, that it easily could have been wrong to attack with that Colossal Dreadmaw. So we can do a double block here and just trade off our 4-2. The flyer's more valuable. I don't really care about this Green Seeker. I still have one. There's 13 cards left in the deck. They've done their job. Of course, we'll activate it before it dies. So, no real reason to let them get a gang block. Not that I think they would do it anyway, but there's not going to be a better target, and I don't think this is going to change their play. And we're going to only have the one attacker anyway. I should absolutely be conservative in this scenario. We have a nice 6-6 trample. I'm not going to send the flyer here. Just save it for defense. Ooh, that's a nice one. And they get to buy back Spirit Flame. I don't think that's going to be enough for them to win, but you never know. It does pump itself. They have Spirit Flame now to take out Spark Tongue. This could get tight. Keep clearing those lands, though. So, what can we do? Think we can attack with the Dreadmaw safely for sure. They definitely don't have 10 on board if they Spirit Flame the Spark Tongue and attack us with the Lathless. We do have to kill them on the following turn. I think the 6-6 trample goes a long way, but I think it's going to be close. I think there's almost no shot they'll block the Thornhide Wolves with Lathless because we could just deal 4 to it and finish it off. So I might be prepared to bluff with that. The only problem is I have to make sure we have enough blockers. But I don't think we'll die unless 2 extra points of damage kills us, which it might. Let's say we send these two. They block the Thornhide on the Dissenter. They get a 2-2, so they have 3 2-2s and Lathless, which is what I think will happen. They go to 3. Then we have 3 blockers. They kill the Spark Tongue, and they have to spend 3 mana to do that, which leaves them 4. That means they can pump all their dragons twice, which this will deal 8. And we'll have 2 blockers for the 3 2-2s, and we'll take 10 and die. So that's not really acceptable. So I think now the right play is probably to activate Fountain of Renewal. It's important that if we find the white tap land, which we have 2 of in the 9 cards, as well as a Dragon's Horde, that we put it into play this turn. I can't tap Green Seeker, I don't think. Well, maybe I can. No, yeah, it's the same as the Dreadmaw. Because if I attack with just Dreadmaw, which is what I plan to do, that leaves me the 3 blockers I need for their 3 2-2s. And then that's after they kill Spark Tongue. So I can't tap Green Seeker now, but I shouldn't need to gain 1 on my next upkeep. So I think now is the time to pop this Fountain. Nice. So now we can Dragon's Horde and play Luminous Bonds. That was big. It was pretty unlucky to not see 1 of 3 white sources in the top 30 cards, but finding this one instead of 1 of the 2 tap lands was huge for us right now. So now, if I play Dragon Sword and Luminous Bonds, Lathless, I'm still at 10. I'm nowhere near dying. I can send the 3-3 flyer, putting them to 6, which means they have to block the Dreadmaw and the Thornhide Wolves. That would still leave me 2 blockers for their potential 2 attackers, because they're going to lose whichever one of these creatures blocks, like, each one of these. They can't block just Thornhide, and they can't block just Dreadmaw. So that'll make the board 2-2 with us at 10. That's a great position. That's pretty safe. So I think that was a very fortunate Dragon Sword for us now. I think now I have a really good attack here. We're killing creatures, getting them really low. There's no way they can, like, disenchant this Luminous Bonds at a black-red. So even if they Active Treason Colossal Dreadmaw or something, they're not going to have 10. They'd have to have another card to play with that or something very surprising. Still may have been a little riskier than necessary sending Thornhide, but they were going to get that same 2-2. We would just have Thornhide untapped if we held back Thornhide. And then we ate an extra 2-2. They had to chump block with the zombie token they previously had out, and this is the new zombie token. So it was hard to accomplish, like, much less. If we attacked with just Dreadmaw, they would just take it, or just block with just Dissenter, and they would have an extra 2-2. So we could have sent, like, nothing if we wanted, but I think sending all three was actually right, because Doom Dissenter was basically going to get to chump and make a 2-2 no matter what if we send Dreadmaw, and sending the Arctic Wolves with it and the 3-3 flyer with it killed an extra 2-2. Maybe we send just Dreadmaw, but then they can just chump with the center. They don't lose any 2-2s. We'd have one more blocker, but 10 is pretty safe there once we drew the answer to the 6-6 flyer. So it's kind of interesting with Plummets. I would never board in Plummet just seeing a Bloodletter, but we did see a Bloodletter, and we saw a Broken Rare Lathless 6-6 flyer, and that makes me think they're likely to have at least one more dragon. You play Lathless even if you have no more dragons, but you draft dragons more aggressively if you get Lathless. So I'm going to go ahead and put in like a Plummet or two, depending on what we can cut. They are a rush deck, and they do have Menace, so I think these Instigators are going to be pretty good against them. We're going to be on the draw this game, so we'll go down to one Tormenting Voice. Don't want to spend too much time on that. And then I think we can lose something from the top end, probably. I forgot we had a second Plummet. That's to think about, too. So these are good against them. Instigators are good against them for sure. Trade straight up with that 4-2 Menace or 3-2 Menace because you have 2/1s. These cards are all pretty good against them. So yeah, it's something from this end. I think we likely have enough late game to beat them without Thornhide Wolves. And to be honest, I think Sarkhan's Unsealing might be a little too slow and situational against them. It's still a good card, but I don't think we need it, even though I was raving about how great it is. And it is in some matchups, truly incredible. But in this matchup, I think I just want to have answers, kind of bring my stuff down. I think I'll still have enough. So I think I'm going to bring in these two Plummets. I still have a Tormenting Voice. I'm on the draw. I've got these Fountains. This should be enough power to beat them, I think. And I shouldn't get run over as easily. And especially on the draw, that's a big concern. On the play, I might go for the Sarkhan's Unsealing again in more of a proactive strategy. A much better hand than last time. We have three lands. We get a tap land and play right away to cast Luminous Bonds and just have one less tap land in our deck. And we still have one of our two Green Seekers for turn two. This is excellent. This is one of those spots where you know the opponent's going to attack whether they have it or not. There's not anything for three mana that really punishes you. They could just finish it with a shock. So I'm going to block. I'll be very unhappy if the Green Seeker dies. And there's pump spells too, like Shore Strike. But ultimately, that two life could win me the game. And it's not like I mean, Green Seeker is very valuable, but I think that I didn't see a lot here. I don't even think I saw a shock out of them or a Shore Strike, and we played a long game. So I'm not going to just give them a free two damage in this spot. So now we can play Dragon Sword and be rampy, or we can play Sky Scanner and get a second blocker. We don't really need to ramp in anything. We can play Giant Spider turn 4, Giant Spider turn 5, and Dreadmaw turn 6. So I think for now the right play is Sky Scanner. I don't think the Horde is doing a lot for us with this hand. It's always nice to ramp, but we just have drops that we can play for the next two turns. And we're going to draw a card off Sky Scanner. We can use Green Seeker. You do want to use Green Seeker before you draw cards if you can, so you can clear lands. But in this case, it's a blocker, so we can't do that. Also, if you don't have two Green Seekers, then it doesn't really matter which time you look. We're going to get to look now to clear the land after the Sky Scanner draws a card. if you had two Green Seekers out and you didn't need them as a blocker, there would be value in going Green Seeker, Sky Scanner, and then Green Seeker. Or Green Seeker, and then Sky Scanner if you didn't hit a land off the first Green Seeker. I mean, sorry, if you did hit a land off the first Green Seeker, but then that would be the same second Green Seeker activation later. Basically, you want to maximize your chance at clearing a land from the top of your deck. Sadly, they drew a Lightning Strike to kill our Green Seeker, so this will be our last activation. But hey, it replaced itself with a land. We're already up a resource. So we could certainly chump a 4-2, but for now we're still at 20. I'll chump long before I'm preventing lethal in a matchup like this sometimes, but not at 20. Just go ahead and play Giant Spider and see what transgresses. It looks like the opponent missed a land drop, doesn't have a swamp, so I'll happily trade that Giant Spider for the Ogre. I'm not worried about needing it for flyers later. I've got another one, I've got Vivian Reed. I probably shouldn't have boarded in both plummets. I kind of forgot about Vivian Reed, but I am mostly scared of losing in the air. We saw that 4 damage removal spell, so they can clear out our Giant Spiders, plus Black-Red generally has plenty of removal, so I wanted to make sure I could actually kill the flyers, not just rely on blocking them. So our defense right now is pretty solid. They'd have to kill both of our creatures, I think, to get Vivian. And we have Dreadmaw behind it anyway. So I don't know if we have to be conservative with it. Especially because we don't even need it to kill that Lathless because we have Plummet in hand. That said, you always want to put out your blockers first. But given they didn't do anything last turn, even if they kill Giant Spider here, we'll chump. Vivian will take two. I think that's fine. So I think I'm going to go ahead and cast Vivian Reed. Plus it, of course. Not that we have a choice. They don't have flying creatures. We could kill our own Sky Scanner. And I'll take Lathless. I like big flying dragons too. And there's no way I would ever attack them for one with Sky Scanner here. That would be absolutely horrible. If they have removal for Giant Spider, we need to chump block with our Sky Scanner. So they picked it off in a turn. And that means there's a chance they have Active Treason or some removal for the Spider here. And they'll kill Vivian, and that's not great. But like I said, we have multiple sixes to play behind it now. We don't need Vivian to win in a matchup like this. So if Vivian forces them to... If it gains me six life, replaces itself with a good six drop anyway, and forces them to use to make attacks like this, to use Shock on a 1-1 flyer that's just a chump blocker, I'm cool with that. So much so that I'm even just going to block their 2-2 here and not their 4-2. If I eat this Dark Dwelling Oracle, is that what it's called? Dark Dwelling Oracle, and then they shock Vivian, I'm cool with that. I don't need this Vivian. I would prefer if the Vivian stayed in play, but with multiple 6-mana cards to play behind it, Giant Spider and Plummet, I just don't need it. Okay, so our only option with Vivian is to plus it, so we'll start there, see what we get. A cheap creature. That's pretty good. So, Vivian's on 3, so we just have to block the Ogre. I kind of want to get this Dragon Sword out before I play the Dragon, but I would rather get out bigger, better stuff, something that just eats the Ogre, not something that trades with it. So this turn is interesting. We could play Colossal Dreadmaw. There's no reason to play Lathless before the Horde right now. Or we could play Dragon's Horde, Basilic, and Stone Quarry. Or actually, we could just play Dragon's Horde and a Spider, which might actually be my play. I hadn't considered that. But really, there's no reason to put a removal in their hand that kills Colossal Dreadmaw. They're not killing us, even if they have Active Treason. It's 12, which is a lot, but it's not lethal. They've used a Shock and a Strike already, and a Spores. I think the right play here is probably to just play Dreadmaw. We can eat the Ogre when they attack. I don't need to get Dragon Sword in play yet. I don't really need to get my tap lands in play so I can do two things next turn. If I draw an untapped land, I can do two things anyway. If they're killing Vivian, they're not dealing me damage. I'm still at 14. So I think at this point, if they want to attack here, I want to eat their 4-2. And if they have Lich's Caress or something, cool. They kill my Dreadmaw, they kill my Vivian, I go to 12, I untap with 6 cards in hand. So, still no targets for Vivian on their side of the board, so we'll be plussing it again. And I do want to stop them from rushing me, and I do have so many good cards in hand, as I said, so I'm not worried about Green Seeker here. I'm going to take Instigator, so we can put out multiple things. and just make sure that menace creature and these ground creatures aren't able to get in anymore. So this turn ends up pretty easy. I think we'll go ahead and play Instigator, Spider, and Tapland. No need to attack with Dreadmaw just yet. I won't wait forever. I might even attack with it next turn, but not this turn. Sparktongue Dragon. Pretty cool card. Not big enough to get through Giant Spider. We have Plummet on the backup. I think this turn I'm probably going to go Dragon Sword into Lathless. I don't believe I need to Vivian away that Sparktongue Dragon. It's just not a scary enough card. I do want to make sure I don't die if they Active Treason Lathless or something. But I have the Spider, so let's say they Active Treason Lathless. I can just chump it. Seems near impossible that they can deal me 14. So yeah, I'm going to plus the... No. How could I lose this game? If just removing their creatures has to be better, right? There's just no... Like, I want to emblem this, but I don't need to end the game quicker. I just need to make sure they can't somehow 14 me, and I don't know how. But I don't need the Vivian minus 3 to kill Lathless because I have Plummet. So I think I'm just going to use Vivian and keep away their flyer. I think it makes the most sense. Especially if I'm going to spend this turn going Dragon Sword and Lathless, which I am. Because next turn I can then tap the Dragon Sword, remove the counter, and draw a card. And I've got my big flyer to start attacking with. So next turn I plan to start attacking. So I think this is the right turn. It's super conservative, but we're in a position where super conservative is what we should be doing. They sack the Bogart Brute digging for cards. I mean the Ogre digging for cards, and they found a Bogart Brute. And part of why they did that, looks like they had a waltz to bring back their creatures. So no matter what, we're going to plus Vivian, because that's all we can do with it. So let's start there. And I will take Sparktongue. And this is going to take out their Dark Dweller Oracle so they can't dig any deeper, make a 5/5 token. This is pretty incredible. Oh yeah, it's not actually kicker after it comes into play. I don't think the order we stack these matters at all. We did just get two counters on our Dragonhawk though. That was sweet. And that was enough for the opponent. On to round two. Round two, we chose to play again. I'm going to be choosing to play with this deck, except post-board if my opponent has a slow deck, because our deck doesn't have a lot of cheap removal. Our deck is incredibly powerful, but it's also very slow. So this is the kind of deck where you really want to be on the play first against aggro. When you're controlling their aggro, but you have a bunch of cheap removal, you want to be on the draw, and your opponent should actually choose to draw against you too. But when you're like a slow, powerful ramp deck, you need to be on the play against aggro. Now, if we know they're a slow deck, then I'll draw, because we're just both slow decks and nobody cares about aggression. Unfortunately, unlike the two Forest Hand round one, I can't keep Mountains in Dryad Greenseeker, because if I whiff, I could end up doing nothing. We have more green cards than red cards, and we can't cast our Greenseekers, so I'm going to go to six here. That's a good six, though. Much better. We can shock an early creature. We can play the Unsealing before we play any of our four-power creatures. We have the White Source, so this is a very good six. Mulliganing on the play can be rough, and I don't think this deck even mulligans particularly well because it's got a lot of expensive cards. But like I said, this is a good six. That's double red, and it doesn't have four power, so I'm going to go ahead and bottom that. I consider lands an okay draw with this deck, even though we don't need lands really with this hand. We know that this deck is loaded with 5+ mana cards. Additionally, that was a card we couldn't even cast, and one that doesn't trigger Sarkhan's Unsealing and doesn't come out until turn 5. So I think it was right to bottom that. So instigators, not something we're happy to see early here by the opponent. Would have much preferred any two drop I can shock, because I'm mostly about prolonging this game and keeping my life total up. Ultimately, if this game goes long, we're going to win with unsealing and just having such a powerful late game deck. But if we take a bunch of damage early, that's a problem. And I can't shock instigator. I could shock half of instigator, but that's not going to do very much. So it looks like the opponent might be playing instigator, though, mostly to stop, to slow down other aggro decks. They look like they're some sort of Grixis ramp control deck. Most people don't play Manalith in aggro decks. You splash less often in aggro decks. So we get the unsealing out, and this is a cast trigger too. So even if they have Essence Scatters and counters out of their control deck, we'll still get to deal four whenever we play a four power creature. Granted, at the moment, that would only be killing one ones, but they're probably gonna play some more real creatures. And maybe my read was a little wrong. There's a 3/3. So now we have an interesting choice. Giant Spider blocking this would certainly be better than Luminous Bonding it, but they've got four cards in hand, and if they have removal, we're gonna take another five. I kind of think I wanna get this Fountain and this Bonds out and just hope they don't play big, super big things that I can't deal with. This could end up costing me the game. It could also end up winning me the game. It's kind of a tough spot, but I think getting the Fountain in play is pretty important. And I also think when your opponent has this many cards, imagine you play this Giant Spider and they like Exclusionary Mage it, or even just use a removal spell on it. Then I'm taking five again and I still don't have anything to do. So I think the right play here is Bonds and Fountain and just hope the opponent doesn't have anything great. I can beat removal pretty easily with my hand, so I want to play to that. And that's a fortunate turn for me because I can just shock that. Also, Spider stops it. So a land getting one card closer to Lathless would be nice. That would allow us to play Giant Spider and hold up Shock. Which means if they have removal for the Spider, then we can Shock the Snapping Drake. No reason to shock the Snapping Drake right now. Maybe they have some kind of pump spell like the +2/+0 black one, and they'll attack with the Drake, and then we'll block and shock and get the real blowout. More than likely, they'll just end up killing the Spider with a removal, like Electrify, and then we'll shock the Drake. But I'm not worried about, like, they kill the Spider and they have a counter spell for the shock or something, or the pump spell. Firstly, it's not that hard to blow out. It comes back into play. It's just alive. I have a flyer as my next play anyway. Any four power creatures I draw are going to be able to kill a Snapping Drake. So we could lose this game if the opponent mind rots this out of our hand. Of course, we'll shock in response, and then we draw all lands or things like that, or if we just draw weak cards. But our library is built for this. This is the exact position we kind of want to be in. We would just like to have more cards in hand. We're stable on board. We're sitting behind a Fountain and an Unsealing. And against their deck, I might be able to sack the Fountain soon. We'll see what they do this turn. This is a big turn. Okay, I like this. Now, don't get me wrong. I might not get any sort of blowout. They might just have like Skeleton Archer to ping it post-combat or something, which would be pretty bad for me. If I knew they had that, I would definitely just shock it. At the very least, though, I'm going to start with a block. I think if they pass here, I might just shock it anyway to avoid Skeleton Archer. But if they go for something like a Shore Strike, I can shock it in response. Because if they passed here, the pump spells that people are most likely going to play is the +2/+0 black one. That card's pretty good in Shore Strike, so I can't really get blown out. If they play the +2/+0 black one in response, it still dies and then just comes back, which I don't really care about. I just don't want to lose my Spider and my Shock and have their Snapping Drake live. But if their Snapping Drake lives and my Spider lives and I trade Shock for like that +2/+0 black instant, no big deal. So that worked out really well, though. We got the blowout. They didn't really play around the Shock because we had two cards in hand. They can't know we have it. So Lathless here, really good, but on exciting with the Sarkhan's Unsealing. So we have to choose whether we want to wait and kill a real creature or play it now. And it's interesting because they definitely don't have Mind Rot. It looks like they're probably splashing black, so maybe they have Nicol Bolas or just some single black card that's good to splash. It doesn't have to be that good. But we have an interesting spot. I mean, I kind of want to hold it because we don't have a lot else going on. If they counter or kill it, killing a 1/1 isn't really helping us. But I also kind of want to get into play and start attacking because it's attacking for 9 and it'll end the game very quickly. But I think I'm going to hold it, to be honest. I think there's a good chance the opponent's holding an Essence Scatter. Blue seems to be one of their main colors. They've got cards in hand. They could easily be holding Essence Scatter or Cancel or Bone to Ash. Their deck's got to play creatures, so sooner or later they'll play one. Okay, well, we'll find out if they have Cancel now, because there's no reason to hold Vivian. It's protected by the Giant Spider. It's got 6 loyalty. They've got 2 1/1s out. We can't play around Cancel. We can't make them cancel something else. If they have Essence Scatter and Bone to Ash, that doesn't work. Only Cancel works. So I love playing Vivian here. Not going to kill their mana lift. They've already got 3 kinds of mana, so we'll just plus it. Well, I'm definitely going to take I want to take Hungering Hydra, because if I play it for 8 mana, which I already have 6, it blows up their whole board, but their whole board isn't very impressive. Blowing up things one at a time might be good enough, and I kind of want to lead this Rocks Oracle, deal 4 to a 1/1, and get it countered so that I can then play Lathless. So I'm going to take Rocks Oracle. It sucks not getting to do that amazing combo of Hungering Hydra for 8 mana, making a 7 power creature come into play and trigger everything here with the Unsealing. If you play a 7 power creature, you get 4 to all of their creatures and planeswalkers. If you play a 4 power creature, you get 4 to one of them. But ultimately, I'm pretty sure this is the right play. This deck could do some really cool things, and I keep not doing them and just making conservative plays because the deck's so powerful and we're just in a good position. So there's no way we're going to blow up Manalith. So once again, let's start with a plus and see what our options end up being. It's not like if we played Rocks Oracle and drew a certain card, we'd then blow up Manalith. We're not going to blow up Manalith. Dry Greenseeker's nice. It's powerful at any stage in the game because it clears lands. But we might just want land. Nah, we already have land 6. Just take a Greenseeker. We can cast our whole hand. And I'm definitely not going to lead Lathless, and I definitely am going to play a creature. So this is just a choice between Rocks Oracle and Thornhide Wolves. I'd kind of rather the Rocks Oracle resolve. They only have 1 card left, though. I don't know if they have any counters. And I still have Lathless that I saved for behind it. So I think I'll just go ahead and run this Rocks Oracle here. We get our trigger, we'll take out the 2-1 because it's better than a 1-1. And let's see. Okay, they didn't do anything. Still got 2 cards. I don't mind discarding the Mind Rot and the Green Seeker in the forest. So play a land. And I could attack with Spider, but I'm not done. I'm gonna play a little bit more conservative than that. Red seems to be one of their main colors. They might have Active Treason or something. It's just 2 damage. If the Spider was a 4-4, I might attack, because then it's 4 damage, but I don't think it's worth the risk just to get into, especially with Vivian out and plussing. Vivian's ultimate ends the game in limited if you have creatures out, which you probably do if you've been plussing it that much. Song of Frailes here, ultimate, Vigilance, Trample, and Indestructible. I really don't know why they give Indestructible on those cards. Obviously, it was a bigger deal on Song than on Vivian if you can ultimate this Planeswalker for 8. Whatever, you're supposed to win if you have other creatures left. But I mean, Song really giving Vig and Trample, so it was hard for your opponent to chump block, and your creatures just got +1/+1, and then you had them back to block with, so you could alpha. You could attack with them all if they have Vigilance, because you're not going to get, like, attacked back or whatever. That would have been perfectly reasonable. That card did not need to give Indestructible. So now, still nothing to pick off with Vivian, so we start with plussing it. I guess I'll just grab another Green Seeker. I don't see them going wide successfully. And I'd rather play the Timberwolves, the Thornhide Wolves and the Green Seeker than Lathless, I think. Lathless ends the game quicker, but I'm going to start attacking anyway. Now we're in a position where we're blowing up their Ogre with the Unsealing. And we can definitely just attack with the Spider this turn. Nothing to be afraid of. We're at 16 life. I'm going to send the Oracle too. No, then they can act and kill Vivian. Yeah, I can't send both. And I don't want to send the Oracle because they'll double block potentially. I'll just send the Spider. That was the right play. And then we'll cast our Green Seeker. Still being kind of conservative. Not real scared of much. If they do play even Nicol Bolas the Ravager, which they could be splashing for, we can just discard a Forest and then play Lathless and deal 4 to it. They're not going to have 11 mana to play it and use it. They're on 9, actually, so that might be something to keep in mind, that we might Vivian a Manalith at some point. we'll see what happens. Looks like they're a control deck. They just played a Take Vengeance off the Manalith. That's pretty surprising, but they probably have two Manaliths or something. So now, unless we're going to kill Manalith, we should start with Vivian. There's nothing scary on 10. I think that card costs 4 and 7 to flip, so it becomes scary at, if they put one more land out. That becomes something to think about. But for now, we'll just plus it. Grab a nice 6/6 trample that can help end this game quickly. And I think now we're going to just play the 6/6 trample so we can kill a 1/1, which means they can't double block the Rocks Oracle. There's an Essence Scatter. I don't know at what point they drew that or if they've been holding it. And our Green Seekers are more than enough to block an Instigator. An Instigator is not something we're afraid of. So we can certainly send these two fours, and we're not going to send Dry Green Seeker. I'd rather tap it than attack with it, even if I knew I didn't need it for attacking or blocking. Okay. Took that game on a mulligan on the play. Not bad, not bad. So against them, we saw Instigator. They didn't play a lot of cards. We saw Snapping Drake. I didn't actually see a lot of flyers, but I'm always scared of flyers because this deck is so good on the ground. I think I want to not get run over. I saw like the 4/2. I'm scared to board in a lot of anti-flyer stuff, though. It's kind of tricky. If people have a lot of flyers, Plummet's amazing. But if they have one or two flyers, you can easily draw Plummet and have them not draw a flyer. I want to take out something expensive up here. I saw an Essence Scatter. One, two, three, four, five, six. We only have six behind the on ceiling, which is not on the high end. It's definitely enough. They have the 3/3 haste. Our spiders line up well against that. Not that I'm considering cutting a spider. I saw a 3/3 haste and Snapping Drake. I'm just kind of trying to debate. Maybe, since we're probably going to be on the draw this game. Although, I don't know. I don't know exactly what the opponent's deck is. It's kind of like four-color blue-red aggro? I don't know. So, from what I saw, though, I like the one Instigator because it stops their Instigators and their 4/2 and their potential Bogrip Root and stuff like that. Kind of want to take out something from the top end, but I feel like if we pull any four power creature out, we almost have to pull Unsealing out. And we're not going to take out the dragon. It goes too well with Lathless. Plus, we're just a ramp deck. We can use the extra pay three with it very well. And we have Dragon Sword to draw a card if we cast it. I kind of want one Plummet, though. I mean, they are blue. We saw a Snapping Drake. They probably have another flyer. In fact, they could easily be splashing for Nicol Bolas, like I kept saying. They could easily not, but we didn't see any black cards, and they're playing Manalith. I think I'm going to put that in. I think my deck is just like, well, Unsealing is better against counter and control than it was last round, but I'm on the draw. I think I'm just going to shave some of this like late game, bring in one Plummet. I'm not going to bring in two Plummets. And then just bring in like another Instigator. Try not to get run over when I'm on the draw. And their card quality didn't seem that high. They played like Shore Strike, and Snapping Drake, 4-mana 3/3 haste. There's an Essence Scatter, Manalith. There's nothing wrong with any of those cards. All of them are fine. Instigator. It's just that it didn't seem like they were really going to crush me on card quality. My card quality is really high, so I actually kind of want to bring it down a little bit to make sure they don't go under me. Like, imagine, we don't know which Instigator it is, but imagine how much worse my hand would be against a turn one Goblin Motivator if this Instigator was Thornhide Wolves or Sarkhan's Unsealing. So I just kind of wanted to bring the deck down a little bit, kind of down to their level, but still with a much better late game. That's a cool card. So we're going to play Sky Scanner, but I don't want to have to chump with a 1-1 flyer. So I think attacking with one of the 2-1-1s makes sense. As far as the Scepter, I don't actually know if that card's good or not. Being able to take repeat extra turns is pretty good, and you can charge it on the extra turn too. So once that thing gets going, you do get substantially more turns than your opponent. The problem is you kind of have to be in a stalemate already. It's just not that likely. Given they just missed a land drop, they can't even activate Scepter. I kind of want to play around counters. I think the right play here is going to be Green Seeker and then Tormenting Voice discarding Luminous Bonds. So I think I'll start with Green Seeker. I don't want to get the Tormenting Voice countered. So if this resolves, I'm not sure what to do. I didn't see a cancel, I saw a scatter. People don't even play a lot of cancels. It's not that big of a deal. Now that the 1-3 resolved though, I'm gonna attack them for 3. Not that worried about them playing a creature and giving it haste now that they missed a land drop and we're kind of out in front. And they're dispersing away a token. Maybe I shouldn't have played the Green Seeker pre-combat. The only thing was if they Essence Scattered the Green Seeker, I wasn't gonna send all 3 creatures. And now we'll do that Tormenting Voice and discard the Luminous Bonds. Just trying to find lands so we can play Oracle and find more lands and play Lathless. I think it's definitely right to Tormenting Voice discarding Luminous Bonds there. Okay, so I'm gonna have Green Seeker back, and I would definitely rather activate it than attack with it anyway. I'm not scared of the Essence Scattering Rocks Oracle instead of Giant Spider. It gets it out of their hand so Lathless can resolve. So I think this is pretty clear this turn. We'll attack with the 2-1-1s and not the Green Seeker, and then we'll just play Land Rocks Oracle. It'd be interesting if we had a Forest for Vivian Reed, which of these two we'd play, probably Vivian. But Vivian's double green, and we only have a single forest. Not that I'm complaining, as the opponent's stuck on 3 lands. And they did have a cancel. But it makes sense what they did. You know, they didn't really want to cancel Green Seeker. It's a good card, but they know I have more powerful stuff than that. And it's not turn 2, it's turn... Not that you can cancel on turn 2, but it's not turn 2, it's turn 4, so... I don't necessarily blame them for that, although I might have been inclined to cancel it. It is a pretty powerful card. It's one of those cards that wins you the game and you don't even realize it, because you cleared 3 lands over 7 turns, and they were like excess lands that you didn't even use. But the thing is, that's like drawing a card. You now are one card close. You then draw the spell that you drew next turn when you would have drawn a land. So Dryad Greenseeker does good work. Okay, so I don't want to play Lathless into all their open mana. So I think I'll play Instigator and Spider this turn. I want to activate the Green Seeker. So the right play this turn will be attack with the 2-1-1s. And then I'll lead the Instigator in case they have a counter. And then play the Spider, because the Spider is the one I want to resolve more. I'm not sure they'll counter the Instigator even if they have a counter. They've been fairly judicious with their counter spells. But nonetheless, a turn where they use a counter, they're not going to be able to use Scepter. And so this turn I want to resolve something if I can. And then next turn they can counter my Lathless or something. Also, having seen Cancel out of their hand already and knowing they have Scatter, if I get a green, I can play Vivian, which they can't counter. But so this game is looking great. I don't know what the opponent has in hand. They have 4 cards. I don't know if they can't cast them. It looks like they tried to draft like a blue-red tempo deck. They've got Bounce, Scatter, Cancel, Haste Creatures, Motivator. Motivator's a card I like a lot in red-white. You Inspire, charge, you Angel of the Dawn, you just want creatures in play. It just combos exceptionally well with Angel of the Dawn, but it's just good in that whole deck. I don't generally like it that much in blue-red, but it can be okay if you just don't have a lot of haste and you have a lot of creatures. Really comes down to the exact composition of your deck. At this point, I kind of want to end the game quickly, but Vivian can kill that Scepter, and they're about to get a second counter on it. What does it need? 3 counters? Yeah, so it's better to kill it one turn later. So I think I probably want to play Lathless here. I'm not worried about any sort of them killing me, even if they steal it or something. So we'll just attack first. And then if they don't counter it, they pretty much have to deal with it. If they, like, switcheroo or something like that, I've got the Vivian to take it out. Okay, so they're Shore Striking to take out my Spider, which is totally reasonable. But
that kind of changes my perception of the turn, because now they have Essence Scatter mana up, but they don't have Scepter mana up. So I think that means I'm going to play Vivian instead of Lathless, because I don't want to let them use that 2 mana and Essence Scatter Lathless. And we saw an Essence Scatter last turn. We're winning by enough that I feel like if we just resolve this Vivian, which it's going to resolve if they have blue and a red up because they can't cast Cancel, that we basically can't lose this game. So this is only counter number 2 on the scepter, so I don't have to kill it with Vivian. So I think we'll start with plussing. Spark Tongue is nice. Nowhere near as important to me as Lathless. And anyways, they can counter it now. Put a second counter on the scepter. We can't play Spider and Lathless. We could play Spark Tongue and Spider. Basically, no matter what, we're not going to be able to really effectively double creature. So it's just a question of whether this turn we want to play Lathless or Spark Tongue. Probably should just use all 8 mana. We don't care about getting the tap land in play. We already discarded our only white card. I think it makes sense. And if they don't scatter it, then we get to deal 3 to their only creature. Not that any of this really matters. I don't really think the opponent can win. Even if they have a Wrath, we still would have Vivian in play. So I'm not really sure how they could win this game or what combination of cards, which kind of makes playing a little less interesting from here. But removing the Chump Blocker does get in damage if they do have some sort of sweeper. And of course, Lathless is better post that than Spark Tongue is. So it seems likely that was the right play. And on to the finals. Round 3, the finals, with our awesome red-green late-game ramp deck. A good hand here. We have Tormenting Voice, we have 4 lands, 2 mountains, 2 forests, we have a 3-drop and a 5-drop. This is an excellent starting hand. So now, drawing another land, I think I'll happily Tormenting Voice away one. We're seeing 3 cards by next turn, and we already have 4, and we only need 1 more to cast Oracle, which then draws more cards. And it's not like if we get stuck on 4, we're going to have nothing to do in the meantime. That's a card I really like a lot. I had Mystic Archaeologist in the pre-release. Sometimes you play it turn 2. Other times you try and wait until you have 7 and play it and activate it immediately. All in all, an excellent card. So I want to get Greenseeker in play as fast as possible. But I also kind of want to use all my mana. So this is kind of an interesting spot. We could cast Basilisk, which I would happily trade for Archaeologist. Or we could play Greenseeker and then next turn play Basilisk. Then we can't play Tormenting Voice and Greenseeker next turn, though. And we could play it and discard a land. I'm not really worried about like that. Greenseeker will help find lands. Plus, we have Draw Step, 2 cards off the Voice, Draw Step to get land 5. So I think I'm just going to play the Basilisk and use all the mana and miss the 1 Greenseeker activation. Kind of unfortunate we didn't have Greenseeker last turn, on turn 2. But I'm not in a position to complain. This is a great hand on the play. Okay, and there's an extra land already to discard. So this turn's going to be Tormenting Voice and then Greenseeker unless I draw anything shocking. If I do draw Shock, I might use it to kill the Archaeologist, but I don't care at all if they just make this trade. So I think we'll attack first and not show them that we have a 1-3 blocker. And then post-combat, we'll be starting with Tormenting Voice and then most likely playing Greenseeker. Archaeologist is very powerful, so I would have been pretty surprised if they blocked. Just a bunch of lands. That's not great. But 2 lands in the graveyard already. 7, that's 9. Only another 8 in the whole deck. 9 if you count the Horde. And we have the Greenseeker, which will help produce spells by clearing lands when we would have drawn them. So I don't hate my chances. Not going to use it upkeep. You can. But ultimately, if I didn't draw a better 5, I was going to play Rocks Oracle, which isn't really a great blocker against Archaeologist, though I would absolutely trade them. So I didn't want to use it upkeep. certainly, it might have been right. But if the Rock's Oracle gets countered, then I'm taking damage potentially and stuff like that. So now I have a choice, though. Vivian into their open mana when they probably can't counter it because Bone, Ash, and Scatter don't work, only Cancel does, or Rock's Oracle. You do want to get Vivian online as early as you can. I think it's unlikely they're going to have exactly Cancel. I kind of want to play things, though, into their counters when they have 5 mana, not 4. But that's kind of moot. So it's important strategy. This was actually really important in Constructed against Glimmer and Disallow. You didn't want to play something good into Disallow on turn 3. Sometimes you didn't want to play anything at all if it looked like your opponent had it in hand. You would then the next turn play it on turn 4, so if they countered it, they couldn't Glimmer. Whereas if you played your good card on turn 3 and they countered it, then turn 4 they'd get to Glimmer. You kind of wanted to choke the cards in their hand that way. It doesn't really come into play here nearly as much. They might not have any counters in hand. This is limited. If they have one Essence Scatter or Bone to Ash only counter creatures, they can't even use it on Vivian. So I think the right play this turn is going to be just play Vivian, and then next turn, if they leave five up, I'll play the creature so that they can't cast Scatter or Bone to Ash and play Archaeologist. But I'm not going to play around exactly Cancel here. I do hope this Vivian resolves, but it's not like I win if it does and lose if it doesn't. Just go ahead and cast it and see if they have Cancel. Hopefully not. We should draw mostly spells from here on out with the Green Seeker to clear lands when they're on the top. Okay, and they didn't have anything, so now we'll plus it, of course, because there's no targets to minus it. We don't need this green-white tap land, just in case we draw Luminous Bonds. I'd much rather have a 4-5. And the only question is whether to attack with the Basilisk, and I think I will. I'm not really worried about them bouncing our 2-drop here. We'll activate it. Vivian can lose 3 loyalty. This would be a great trade with the Archaeologist, and I'm not scared to block with Greenseeker either. So I think the right play is to attack. It's a little aggressive, but with the opponent having an Archaeologist out, we need to be aggressive. If neither player did anything for a long time, the opponent would win. So I don't mind being aggressive. If they use Disperse here to get some loyalty off the Vivian, that's cool. They're not killing it. And they're using Disperse on a 2-drop instead of a 5-drop. So if I knew they had Disperse, I might not make that attack. But even seeing it, I don't really regret it that much. Okay, so we'll start with plussing Vivian because there's nothing to minus it to. I want to be able to do 2 things if possible, so I'm going to go ahead and take Giant Spider. Now I will be slightly conservative since they did use the Disperse and got the Vivian down to 3. Plus I need to be able to stop flyers anyway. And now I can't attack with Dagger back because I needed to block Vinemare. So we'll pass back to them. So all in all, that was a pretty good sequence. Got the Disperse out of their hand. Vivian still got plenty of loyalty. The board looks pretty stable. I do want to find a shock for that Archaeologist. It is a scary card, and I don't have a lot of removal, as I've said. But right now, Vivian can do more than Archaeologist, I think. I mean, they're drawing 2 cards. I'm drawing the best creature in my top 4. And we know this deck does very powerful things. Like a giant Hungering Hydra. And I don't need Fountain Out, so I'll probably play Hungering Hydra for 6. Although that card does continue to grow. So maybe the right play here is not the Hungering Hydra. Let's think. This is an interesting turn. So I can use 6 mana of 7 if I just play Fountain in one of the 5-drops. And I could play the Rock's Oracle, since the only creatures they have out are Vinemere and Archaeologist that can trade with it, and those are both good trades with it. And I could see Shock. I didn't see Shock, I don't think, in those Vivian activations. I wasn't paying that close of attention. So if I put 6 cards on the bottom already, and I didn't see Shock yet, which I don't think I did in the first one, but I don't remember that well. I've got an okay chance, 1 in 13, of hitting it. Unfortunately, I don't think I have any other removal, but I really would love to kill that Archaeologist. I think I'm going to do that. I also might find the Unseen, and having the Hungering Hydra for 7 could be game-winning, and it's my only 7-power creature. Plus, it's just only going to get bigger anyway. No reason to show them Fountain yet, because I am going to attack now with the Basilisk, I think. So Still have plenty of blockers. This is the same quality blocker the Basilisk was last turn. And now we'll play the Fountain and pass the turn. So we didn't really draw any of our interaction, but we're doing our own proactive thing. They can draw two cards a turn extra, which is really scary, but we're plussing Vivian, we're green seekering, and our late game is pretty great. So I like our chances here, but it's going to come down to what they have. Dwindle on the 4-2 is totally fine by me. They have to have some stuff. That's no big deal. If they attack with 5-3, I'll happily double block it. Actually, I might just chump it with the rock since it's going to die anyway. Although, I think this would be a good double block. As good as Greenseeker is, taking out a Vine Mare right now seems better. Vine Mare is a little scary. You never know when that could get enchanted or something. I don't think this is the kind of matchup where life is very important, so there's a good chance I'm going to board these fountains out for the first time. Just have more ammunition for the resource battle. For now, though, we've got 7 mana. I'm not going to minus 3 Vivian to kill Sky Scanner, so I'm going to plus it. Oh, wait. I can kill enchantments. I might kill Dwindle. Yeah, I think that's going to be better, probably. So I'll probably cast Dragon's Horde and Thornhide Wolves. And then I can Vivian the Dwindle. I can attack with the 4-2, which they could block with the 2-1-1s, which isn't great for me. But it's still clearing blockers. I can send the Basilisk 2, which they could also block with the 2-1-1s if I don't do that. And then I'll play the Wolves. If they have something for the Wolves, I've got the Spider and Greenseeker on tap to double block the Vine Mare. I like that. I don't want to dig. I've already seen 23 of my 40 cards. I don't want to just run through all my resources super fast. Like, Vivian killing Dwindle creates a 4-2, basically. And this is the kind of matchup where they're drawing extra cards, I'm drawing extra cards. I want to make sure that my resources overpower theirs. And these two are pretty clear attacks here. Any trade with the Archaeologist is a good one at this stage in the game. Any trade with the Vine Mare with these two is a good one. And it's not a good trade, really, for me to trade either of these for the 2-1-1s, but I can't really avoid it. It's not like there's something I can really do about it. Well, that's a little bit weird. Maybe they have some plans for the Sky Scanner. With a Spider in play, I would normally have expected them to just throw that in front of the... They'd be trading a 1-1 for a 4-2 if they had thrown the Sky Scanner in front of it, too. Now, the opponent made that choice, so I'm going to assume what that tells us is they have some plans for that Sky Scanner. Maybe they're going to bounce the Spider and enchant the Sky Scanner or something and take out Vivian. That would certainly make their play correct. It's more important that they kill Vivian than it is they kill Rock's Oracle. And maybe they don't have that, but they have outs along those lines. I could see, even if it's just giving them outs to kill Vivian, that play could be correct. That said, if not, then they certainly should have traded a 1-1 for a 4-2 on this board. Because it's not like the 4-2 is getting blanked here. It's just going to attack again this turn. Meanwhile, the scanner didn't attack or block. Okay, and I guess they didn't really have outs. The opponent has conceded. So, I saw Sky Scanner and Dwindle to naturalize, which isn't great, but they could have other things. I saw just Sky Scanner for Plummet, but they are blue. So this is kind of interesting. I do feel like the Fountain Renewals are quite bad against them. This doesn't seem like the kind of matchup that's necessarily going to come down to life very much. And also, their deck doesn't look especially good at punishing one toughness creatures. So if anything, I'd rather just have a Highland game to play on turn two. Although, actually, that's not true. They have Sky Scanner and Rejuvenator. I said that because they don't have things that deal one and stuff like that. But actually, their deck is quite good at punishing one toughness creatures. So pretend I didn't say that. That said, Marauder's Axe tends to be pretty good in these kind of matchups. So I think what I'll probably do is take out Fountains, bring an Axe. Do I have anything else that's bad against them? The Bonds could be good. I want my late game in this matchup. Not bringing my deck down this time. So yeah, I'll just bring in the other instigator so I can get on the board, and then if I draw axe, that'll work, and if not, I have chump blockers for the 5-3 hexproof and things like that. That it's hardly like this deck can't deal with a flyer. I didn't really see any since I only saw Sky Scanner, but if they do have one, I've got Vivian, two spiders, and a Bonds, Sarkin's on ceiling, Spark Tongue does three, my own big flyer. Certainly I would board in Plummets for game three if I see flyers, but I don't want to board in Plummets when I already have several ways to interact with flyers, and I saw one Sky Scanner. I do really like Sky Scanner, though. This is a format where Flood Out is a real problem, I think. So even you want to play only 16 or 17 lands, but of course there's a lot of powerful 4, 5, and 6 mana cards, and you still want to make your land drops. So I think Sky Scanner, out of the 17 land decks that like this one that have 5s and 6s, can be really good. This isn't really a 17 land deck because Horde is an 18th land, just a good one that draws a card sometimes. And also Green Seekers help you find land and Tormenting Voice. But I do think this is the kind of format where it's important to play things like Tormenting Voice and that help you kind of deal with Flood. I think that Waltz and Voice are very useful cards that most decks should play one to two of. Assuming you're not like a 16 land aggro deck. And even then, you still don't want to Flood and you need to hit land drops early. Well, we could shock it now, we could shock it later. I'm not that worried about them having a cancel, and we might go Green Seeker Shock. We do have two of those, plus other two drops. So I'll gamble on being able to use my 1 mana instant later. I don't care about the two damage. The only way I'll regret this play is if somehow I'm unable to shock the Archaeologist, like if they were to enchant it, or if they just successfully managed to use a pump spell or a counter spell in response to shock. But I think it was certainly worth casting the Tormenting Voice to see two additional cards for this turn and have a shot at a two-drop with the shock. We didn't find one, so now we'll shock it anyway. Certainly not looking to save shock for something better than Archaeologist, which is one of the best shock targets in the format. Hopefully it's not the Vine Mare, because we have the Sarkin's on ceiling, but it has Hexproof, and Giant Spider can't block it. So that was the worst possible 4-drop they could play for us. Vine Mare lines up quite good against this deck. Our 4-drops are 2/4s that block flyers. So I actually think for now, I probably want to cast Sky Scanner. Even though it's not the most efficient use of mana, it's off by one. I kind of need to try and find something I can put in front of this Vine Mare. I could just play the Unsealing this turn in case I draw it next turn. I mean, I'm not excited about pinging the Sky Scanner, but they might play a real creature. And also, I can double block the Vine Mare with Scanner and Spider. So I think, yeah, I think I want to play... maybe I should just play Spider. And then next turn, I can play Scanner. And then it costs one less, and if I draw Green Seeker off draw step or off Scanner, I can play it. Or Goblin Instigator, which I now have two of. All right, I'll use all my mana. I'll play Limited the right way. I won't get fancy here. Try not to suffer from fancy play syndrome. I could certainly construct scenarios where the right play this turn is Sky Scanner, but ultimately, knowing I have a lot of good 2-mana plays I might draw, it's probably better to just use all my mana. And I don't like taking hits for 5, but as early as next turn, if I resolve Sky Scanner, I don't mind double blocking and getting sort of 2-for-1 because Sky Scanner draws a card. So we'll see what else the opponent has. And if they have a counter and I take another 5, that one stings a little, but I got a Dreadmaw after that. So I shouldn't lose the game to this Vine Mare unless some unexpected things happen. But I am kind of scared of sleep. I am kind of scared of it getting equipped, enchanted, etc. So definitely looking to keep my life total as high as possible. And speaking of, that means I think I will cast Daggerback Basilisk here. Hopefully they don't have a scatter. Cool. If we can get this game stable, we'll be in great shape. Because then we can drop the Unsealing and then the Dreadmaw, killing any real creatures. And we're already about to be at 6 lands, so Lathless will be online. If we ever find the Hydra as a 7-7 will be online. And they are playing aggressive, and that's pretty scary. In fact, I think now I am going to get kind of fancy and just chump block. I mean, that's such an aggressive play. I don't want to lose this game to sleep unnecessarily. Blue-green loves to play sleep. Green creatures is what sleep goes well with. It's bad in, like, blue-black control and stuff like that. They're here. They're 2-0 in the finals, probably. They just made a really aggressive play. So, well, I don't have to play Dreadmaw. I'll play the 3-drop this way. If they counter it, I can play the Sky Scanner too. But, and I want to play the Dreadmaw after the Sarkin's Unsealing anyway. But yeah, if they're going to go and disperse a Daggerback Basilisk, I'm cool with chumping with a Spider there. I'm not that scared of a Flyer because I'll be able to deal 4 to it most likely. So at least I bought some time there. That looks pretty automatic. The only question is if we want to trade these. And they don't have any other creatures out, so I think I will. And then I can play my Dreadmaw. I really am going pretty far to play around Sleep a little bit here. But honestly, like, that Disperse play was just so aggressive. Like, I wouldn't have made that play otherwise. If your opponent makes that aggressive of a play, you want to give them credit. You don't want to assume they just did it because they love damage. You want to assume they did it because at least if Sleep's not in their hand, it's an out in their deck or something else is. So that's not great. They're going to start drawing 2 cards a turn. But if I draw the Hydra, I'll win the game. If I draw Lathless, I'll be in pretty good shape. So for now, I got to get the Sarkin's Unsealing in play. If they draw a Bounce Spell for this Dreadmaw, I know they're not holding one. Even though they're drawing 2 cards, they're not Demonic Tutoring. It's just 2 cards instead of 1. I'll take my chances. If they don't draw one, now I can draw the Hydra to win the game. I can start picking things off every time I play something, starting with the Flyer or a better Flyer if they play one. So this is a really swingy big turn here. If they brick this turn, I need to just draw stuff, but I have a lot of really good stuff. If I draw Vivian, I can kill the Majesty. If I draw Hydra, I can wrath their board. If they play like a Snapping Drake, I can play Thornhide Wolves, effectively Flame Tongue Cavu, dealing 4 damage to the Drake and getting a 4-5. So as long as I can draw spells and not just lands from here on out, I'll be in decent shape. And I think to the point, I think I'm actually at this point going to attack with the Dreadmaw. If they had up a bounce, they don't have a bounce spell, they'd have to top it. They are getting 2 cards. But 6-6 trample's a lot. They can't trade with it. They can't chump it, really, because it has trample. I want to make sure this resolves first, of course, because I need to be able to block the Vine Mare in the event they don't have anything. But I'll be happy as can be to trade for Vine Mare. And hits for 6 add up, so I think we're going to go ahead and attack here. Especially because we're losing the long game here with the Majesty. If the board was the same and this Majesty was like some kind of creature that wasn't really affecting much, you know, a reasonable creature, like a 3-3 or something, I would not make this attack. I would play for the long game. But with them drawing 2 cards a turn, I actually, even if I'm disadvantaged in the short game, I kind of have to play the short game because I'm not going to beat 2 cards a turn if I'm drawing 1 card a turn. Hopefully they brick this turn, and by brick, I don't mean land. They could draw a 3-3, they could draw a small Flyer, and then I can draw, Hydra would be amazing. Well, that doesn't change much. But Hydra would be amazing. Lathless would be quite good. Vivian would be quite good. So I've got some big draws. I'm actually kind of surprised they put it there instead of the Flyer, unless they have something else. A little weird. They probably do have something, and it's not a big deal because it's going to die anyway, and then they get it back. So maybe they figured they get in the same one, but they have the option to use it on something else next turn, which is, the logic is sound. You just have to spend 5 more mana, but maybe they don't have much to do, so they know they'll buy it back now, and then it only costs 2 to play. Yeah, it looks like that was what they were thinking. Which I can respect. They don't know where the best home for it's going to be next turn. Well, it looks like they're playing it, so then I don't know why they didn't just put on the Flyer. I guess in case I had a removal spell for the Flyer, since I couldn't kill the Vine Mare, it just ensures the 1 damage. So I need to draw something here. Mountain's not going to do it. I'm not dead on board. I'm taking 3, but I can't attack, so this is pretty bad. I still have a land to discard a Tormenting Voice, and who knows what I'll draw into if I draw that. So or a Vivian Plus or something, so I'm going to play the land. I'm not going to hold 2. So this was a really bad turn, though. I needed to draw something there. It didn't have to be, you know, Hydra for the win, Hydra for blow up their whole board and deal 4 to them and make a 9-9. any 4-power plus creature is a good draw for me there. Kill the courser, hit you for 6 is really strong. So I don't like what they did there with the Talons. I would have put it on the flyer. If they didn't want to play it on the flyer that one turn because I had to trade with the Vine Mirror, that's fine. But then when the flyer hit me, I probably wouldn't have cast it at all because they were going to have 11 mana for next turn. But if I was going to cast it, I would definitely have put it on the Thopter there. So can I draw Hydra? Ugh. Gross. And I know they're drawing a lot of lands too. Oh, my mistake. They made that play because of Majesty. They'd only be drawing one card a turn, not two. I apologize. I'm wrong. They played correctly. Getting an extra card a turn is worth more than getting an extra damage a turn. Everything they did was right. If they put it on the flyer, I would trade with the mayor. It would just still be on the flyer. They played perfectly. They traded the mayor off with it, got in the one extra damage, and then put it on the courser so that they could still draw two cards a turn. My mistake. Okay, well, this game's getting worse and worse, but I could still draw Hydra for sure. Well, not for sure anymore, because Ford Everything doesn't actually kill that. May have no outs now. Looks like we're going to our first game 3 with this really awesome deck. It's fitting that it's in the finals. So I still didn't really see anything to plummet. I saw one Snapping Drake and a Thopter. I mean, Snapping Drake is a real target for it, but I'm on the play. So I'm not that scared of that. I did see better targets for Enchantment Kill now. Majesty is really good and quite good against me. So I probably want the Naturalize because they already had Dwindle, which is a good target. And then there's the stuff like the Thopter and the Sky Scanner. So I almost certainly want Naturalize. I don't think I'm going to bring in Plummet, though. I'm less concerned about making my 2-drop or falling behind. So I think I'll just take one of those 1-1s out, bring in a Naturalize. Their creatures aren't really much bigger than mine. I don't think I need Shore Strike. I think that's pretty much all the changing I'm going to do. Certainly wouldn't be bad to bring in Plummet. I mean, you know they have 2 different 1-1 flyers you can clip in addition to the good target Snapping Drake. But I have 2 Giant Spiders, my own flyers, and I'm on the play first this game. I'm really just not that scared of Snapping Drake. Hopefully with double Green Seeker here, we can just draw a nice hand with 2 or 3 lands and a Green Seeker, and then start drawing lands when we activate it, cast things every turn, and just get a nice, easy win. Green Seeker really is incredible. Sometimes it's high variance, of course. Sometimes it doesn't do a lot. But when you play that thing turn 2 and you hit with it a couple times over the first 4 or 5 turns, I mean, you've robbed the bank. You paid 2 mana for a 1/3 and you drew 2 to 3 cards. So even though their deck's not that fast, it is disperse. It feels like a play first type deck. My deck doesn't have removal, really, as we've been talking about. I love drawing first and limited, but I also love removal. And when you have 1 shock, 1 Luminous Bonds off the splash, you need to be on the play. My deck is not good at killing things, but its own proactive game is about as powerful as it gets. And I'm pretty good at making land drops. 17, I've got the Horde as 18 if I have 3. I've got a Sky Scanner if I have 3, but I also have 2 Tormenting Voices and 2 Green Seekers if I only have 2. So there's a decent chance that if I'm stuck on 2, I'll hit off Green Seeker after my draw step, since it's going to be about another 50%er. So my deck is really, really good at making land drops. And speaking of, I don't need a second tap land. So, and we already have a double red and we already have our white in play. So this turn is really easy. We'll Tormenting, discarding Stone Quarry. Though I do need more lands, I have a lot of time to find them. Although in the first 3 cards I didn't. But I didn't even have the Instigator to discard, so I wasn't going to discard one of my good 5 drops that was in my hand. Right now, if I could put Stone Quarry in my hand and Instigator in the yard, I probably would. But we drew 3 cards already. We have this draw step and the next draw step. We don't even have any tap lands left in our deck. Hopefully, we'll just draw a land. I would consider a land, Sarkhan's Unsealing, a Shock, Sky Scanner, a Green Seeker. We have a lot of good draws here. Just don't keep drawing random 5s. It's going to be pretty funny, though, if I get stuck on 4. I mean, what do you want me to say? I mean, I had 3 lands in hand on turn 2 before I cast Tormenting Voice. So you get the 2 cards from Voice and 3 draw steps to find 1 land. But I am very scared of that Mystic Archaeologist. I really need to draw land or shock, because if that thing starts activating and I'm not doing much, I'm probably going to lose. And that does seem like what's going to happen now. So this game is rough. If I had the land, I could drop Thornhide Wolves, start attacking them. They could only afford to pay 5. You draw 2 cards so often. And the thing about cards, you're not adding to the board. So draw 2 once isn't very scary, right? That's divination. But if they can afford to draw 2, then make the board stable with those cards, then draw 2 again, they're just going to win. So this was really bad not having land 5, turn 5 here, game 3 of the finals. But, I mean, it was definitely right to discard that Stone Quarry. I could have discarded one of my 2 5 drops and drawn like land and instigator and then untapped and drawn a land, and I would literally have like 1 5 drop and an instigator for the whole rest of the game. Just kind of unfortunate so far. But it's still a game, of course. We have Green Seeker now. Hopefully we'll get there and draw step plus Green Seeker. So I can't cast anything except Tormenting Voice right now. I would much rather cast a Thornhide Wolves this turn than Tormenting Voice. So hopefully we'll get there. I'm going to activate Green Seeker first. No luck. So now we have to cast Tormenting Voice. Really easy choice on what to discard. It's going to be one of the Wolves because the Dragon's combo. Wow, still no lands, huh? Okay, well, can't attack. And I definitely wouldn't Green Seeker upkeep in a spot like this, because I want lands, not necessarily to clear them. So if the top card of my deck is not a land, then I can use Green Seeker and have another card to find the land. Pretty disappointed with how this is going. They have a sweet deck, so do I. I would like us to be having a real good fight. Not that I can't still win this game, but if I drew a land there and then I untapped and had a land with Green Seeker in a draw step, I could have at least played Lathless this turn. Pretty disappointed in the amount of land drops I've missed. I've had, I don't even know now, 7-8 cards without a land. Okay, so we have a land to play and there's no more tap lands in our deck. So there's no reason now to activate Green Seeker. I think this is a pretty clear Sarkhan's Unsealing turn. I'm not really loving life, but get that thing online. Actually, well, Luminous Bonds is in consideration because there is a 3-3, one of the biggest creatures that we can Luminous Bonds that we've seen out of them. And given Archaeologist can't really block, we could attack Vivian for a lot. But I can also, I need to be able to cast Lathless if I draw land, Wolves if not. I need to get the Sarkhan's Unsealing out. Hopefully I can't kill it. And ultimately, getting this going will be really powerful, assuming... Oh, they have Vivian, so they can kill it, but that doesn't actually make the play wrong, because if they minus Vivian instead of plusing it and put it down to 3 loyalty, I may have the opportunity to hit Vivian anyway. But I definitely should have thought of that before I played it. I think there's a good chance it would have still been the right play, but it might not have been. I'm playing kind of sloppy because I'm a little bit on tilt, I think. Okay, and they have a 4-4 flyer. So this turn, I'd really like to get Lathless in play so that I can then do Spark Tongue. And now the Luminous Bond doesn't really give us an attack past the 3-3, which was the upside of Luminous Bond that turn. We get to deal some damage to the Vivian. And then if they want to minus the Luminous Bond, the Vivian would be really low or dead. And then but the thing about the Unsealing is it's like, then we'd still have the Unsealing, but you still have to play the Unsealing before you play creatures. So it's kind of an interesting spot. For now, though, 6-6 is bigger than 4-4. It doesn't have Trample, but we do have another Dragon. So I think this turn, if they want to kill Lathless with Vivian, then we're at least through Vivian. And if they don't, then if they plus Vivian, planning to chump block the Lathless, then we can play Spark Tongue and get another 5-5 flyer. Maybe we can Luminous Bond the Scholar. They still have the Scanner to chump, but we'll have a 3-3 flyer and 6-6 and a 5-5. If they Vivian here, which wouldn't shock me at all given they have Archaeologist for more resources, it's not great that Vivian did so much, but it's kind of like, what are you going to do? Like, Vivian's out. I can't really successfully attack into it. So all I can do really right now is kind of hope that they don't have their Disperse, that they're just going to play a creature or two. Like, this game is going pretty poorly. I probably should have Luminous Bonds that one turn. Like I said, I kind of forgot that Vivian could just kill an enchantment, which you think I wouldn't forget given I have a Vivian. But I think it would have been a close play anyway. Because I couldn't kill Vivian by any stretch. If I could kill Vivian by casting Luminous Bonds, I would have slapped Luminous Bonds down. So, let's see. I can replay Laughless if they Vivian it. I can Spark Tongue the Vivian. It's not the worst. I could play a 6-6 Hydra, but they've got a lot of chump blockers. So I think that's the play. I think I'm just going to slap Laughless back down. Definitely hope they don't Vivian it, because they have multiple flyers out, including a Sky Scanner. And I have Spark Tongue, but I don't know if they will or won't. I wouldn't be really surprised either way. It depends on what they have. I didn't really see a ton of great stuff out of them for spots like this. If they have Sleep, I can just concede. Other than that, if Switcheroo would have been really good. But I can kill my own Laughless, and they probably don't have Dragons. And that's actually a good sign that they're drawing two. I'm not saying I'm in good shape, but it means they probably don't have a lot of good business. And, of course, I mentioned Sleep last game because when they made that Disperse play, they only had a couple cards in hand, and then I super flooded out, but I thought I was in pretty good shape, and I wouldn't need that Spider. This game, that's a card I would just ignore. Pretty good rule of Magic strategy. If you can't beat something, play like it doesn't exist, and that's a card I'll just right-click concede to. That's not a card I'll try and beat in this game. But now, I don't have any flyers, so I can't take out the Sky Scanner to attack Vivian. So I just have to take out Vivian. This does 3 damage to any target, though, so I can get rid of their Planeswalker. I'd say it's done enough. Strong them several cards and killed Laughless and Sarkhan's Unsealing. I'm not even sure if I'm going to be able to win without those. And my opponent drawing 2 cards a turn with Archaeologist, but I can't kill Archaeologist. I have to kill Vivian. I don't even think that was close. And I do have the bonds already for the Horizon Scholar, so kind of just going to have to hope that now I can use my card advantage engine here, Dry Green Seeker, to make sure I draw spells every turn. And the opponent only has 14 cards left. Their deck doesn't necessarily seem great at getting through, assuming they don't have a Sleep. I can definitely beat a Talons. So we'll kind of see how this goes. There is some reasonable chance I will deck them this game, which is kind of the plan right now, strangely. So let's see. They're getting aggressive, as they should. I kind of want a naturalized Dwindle, but I might need to just chump with the Spark Tongue right now. So let's see what our options are. I don't think they're going to have Pump or anything. They even use their Disperse. I think they're just making this attack because it's a good attack. We're not going to block Scholar. We don't have a profitable block there. We don't need Giant Spider, but they do have a 1-1 Thopter and a Sky Scanner. We still have one Spider left in our deck, though. So I think Spider does want to block here pretty bad, along with a 1-1 for like a free kill. I can take 2 of these 3, but not 3, so then I have to choose if I want to put up in front of a Vine Mare, the Spark Tongue, or the Instigator. I think naturalizing the Dwindle is very likely to occur. I don't even really care about a draw 2 cards a turn enchantment at this point in the game. Basically, I am just trying to beat everything they have now. So I think I'll just throw a 1-1 in front so that I can free up a 3-3 flyer with Naturalize. And I'll take 9. I am kind of scared of an Alpha, though. Am I going to have enough blockers? I do have this to block with to stop like this stuff. And they really don't have a lot of power. This is going away. So they're going to have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 creatures. I'm going to have 1, 2, 3 plus what I play. And I can Bonds the 4-4 flyer and play like Arctic Wolves, Thornhide Wolves. I think Arctic Wolves is something with Cumulative Upkeep. And I'm going to have 9 mana, so I can, no, that's 10, to play Naturalized Bonds and Wolves. If they're probably going to be able to add something to the board. I'm not trying to beat anything incredible, but I do have to assume they can add something to the board now. I don't know what I would do, really, other than this. I mean, I can chump with the Spark Tongue later, so I guess this almost has to be the right play. So that was a good attack by them. They're playing really well. I still got pretty unlucky if I just had land 5. I think that this is a very different game. But I think the opponent is playing really well. Of course, we'll Green Seeker end a turn. So we have 9 mana at our disposal. If I make a 6/6 or 7/7, I could naturalize Dwindle and then double block Scholar. I only have 4 blockers though. I think that's not really enough. I think I need to just play the 4/5 and Luminous Bonds this turn. The 4/5 can trade with a Vine Mare. That's pretty good. And I can't expect a Luminous Bond something better than Horizon Scholar. I wish I had seen that in games 1 or 2, even just in losing to it, you know, in the game I would have lost anyway or something, because I could have boarded in Plummets. I saw a couple 1/1s, but I didn't want to plummet a Skyscanner or a Thopter, but I saw Snapping Drake. So if I would have seen Scholar 2, I would have boarded in at least 1 Plummet. So this is a pretty key turn. I can beat random green creatures. I don't know if that lethals me or not, them freeing it up. They have 7 to my 4, which means 3 gets through. So if they realize they have exactly lethal, well played. Disappointing, because I still had the chump blocker here and the naturalized to free up the 3/3 and the Hydra. Also, this deck was incredible. Their deck's good. I think my deck's better, but the cards lined up how they do. And this was a fun draft and a sweet deck. So hopefully next time I can get the victory.